straight to the point, it's impossible to create variable radius fillets in Blender. Or is it? Let's have a look. But first, a quick warning. I don't think we have an awesome solution for variable radius fillets in Blender yet. At least not in the vanilla Blender. There are plugins like Mesh Machine that definitely can do it, but in this tutorial we'll try to tackle this problem using the default Blender tools. So throughout this video we'll be dealing with intricate washouts, chamfers and other such stuff, so keep watching. Okay, so we have a subdivided cube with a bunch of segments over there, and it's important that it has a few edge loops. And before we jump straight in, I will enable auto smooth and set the angle to 30 degrees. That's a standard preparation tactics. And on the same note, I will apply the scale. That is crucial, because otherwise the bevel will get slanted and we don't need it. Now it's just a matter of adding the bevel modifier, because as we are gonna be dealing with chamfers and bevels, naturally we are gonna be using the bevel modifier. But here's the catch, the weight mode. We need the weight mode precisely because we will be adjusting the edge bevel widths on those edges separately, so we can achieve a sort of a gradient. We can also access and manipulate bevel widths on the right hand menu that you can bring up by pressing the N key. And immediately after we try adjusting the bevel widths for those edges, it becomes clear that something is not going right here, because the bevel is not getting progressively smaller, even though it should go from 1 to 0.5 to 0.3, and that is because we need to switch over to the percent mode. Is it a feature or a bug? It's a matter of perspective, I guess, but once we set it to percent, it works. I'll also jack up the number of segments to achieve a smoother bevel, and what I want to do here is basically set up a small rounding that gets progressively wider as it travels to the left. A nice little trick to control the width is to draw a few additional edge loops. We can do it by pressing Ctrl R, and then we can press G and G again to slide those edges. And by sliding them, we can kind of constrain the bevel width in this area, because we are using the percentage mode. But anyway, let's get a few steps back by Ctrl Z a few times. So that's the basics of what we can achieve by utilizing the width mode of the bevel modifier, but it can take us this far. So the real fun starts when we collapse the modifier stack to get access to the geometry, so we can bevel individual edges. This is where the real stuff happens. And to not mess the object up, I will duplicate it by pressing the Shift-D hotkey. And of course, that's a cheap alternative to the non-destructive workflow with modifiers, but it's better than nothing. So technically, my proposition is to create backups from time to time. Alright, next I will select all the edges that we have assigned the bevel weight to. And I will press -1 to pretty much reset it. We won't be using the bevel modifier in this context. Instead, we will be using a good old bevel tool. So it works like this, you select the edge and you bevel it. As usual, all the parameters of the operation can be controlled in the lower left menu, but once you do some other operation, you will no longer have access to it, so be considerate, or create backups for that matter. So I rounded up this edge a little bit by giving it 9 segments and making it pretty wide in terms of beveling. Now we can select those guys and go Ctrl B, or just use the gizmo of the bevel tool. This time let's aim at the medium-sized bevel with like 3 or 5 segments. And for this set of edges, I think they deserve a really tiny bevel with just 1 segment. Unsurprisingly, the point where those chamfers transition into one another is the most problematic thing that we have to solve by sliding the edge like this a little bit. So first we need to track the intersecting edge. If we zoom in, we will see that this part of the geometry overlaps, so we select this edge and GG to slide it slightly to the right. Yes, it's not perfect, but it works fairly well. And here we see the rendering artifacts. Hello, long time no see. What we can do about it is make use of the weighted normal modifier that hopefully will fix it for us. Pop in the Keep Sharp checkbox. The shading magically became more professional in one click, thanks to awesome Blender developers. And one more thing that we can do to alleviate the potential shading problems is to select the potentially problematic edges and right-click Mark Sharp. That will tell Blender that no matter what, these edges should stay sharp in terms of shading. In other words, that any interpolation efforts should just stop when hitting one of those edges. I'm going to do the same for those edges too. Right-click, Mark Sharp. Awesome possum. Now let's try to recreate a so-called washout effect. Very interesting transition from one shape to another by the means of beveling. So first I'm beveling those two edges. I'm going to crank up the segments to some insane number, like 30. We will be transitioning into a kind of a spherical curvature, so we will need those extra segments for extra smoothness. And now I will select all those edges on the other side of the mesh. Then we will need to firstly make sure that we have the loop tools add-on enabled. That's one of the default add-ons, just activated. And once we have sorted it out, we can use the relax command within the loop tools menu. And in order to conjure a really smooth spherical falloff, so to speak, we can firstly increase the iterations, then set the interpolation from cubic to linear. It's important, otherwise it will have a slightly wavy shape. And then I'm just pressing Shift R to death a few times. Shift R, Shift R, Shift R to repeat the operation. Or I'm just holding Shift R, in fact. And in addition to that, we can space those edges evenly by utilizing the space command of the same loop tools add-on. See, it's invaluable. The space thing distributes the edges evenly. We can utilize it in this area of the mesh as well. Select those edges, right-click, loop tools, space. And okay, we can push this washout effect even further by beveling this edge and setting up a considerable number of segments to make the transition really smooth. It can be further tweaked by the profile setting to make it slightly bulged or indented, I guess. Actually, the operation is slightly more complicated than I'm trying to describe. Alright, and here I wanted to show yet another way of creating the washout, that is by bridging a set of edges. So first we need to delete the polygons connecting those edges and then select the boundary loops. Loop tools bridge, yet another awesome function of the loop tools add-on. After bridging those loops, we can tweak the twist parameter so the connection is more or less straight. And again, don't write the good old bevel tool off so quickly. We can achieve many interesting effects by simply dissolving a couple of edges, then Control B to bevel this guy and control the profile of it. It can be found in this menu. It goes from 0 to 1, where 0.5 represents kind of the average. Alright, so I guess we created a bunch of pretty cool washouts and variable radii chamfers. It's not exactly a substitute for proper solid modeling workflow like in Fusion 360 or Moy 3D, but that's a decent alternative to consider. And certainly a way out of some hellish 3D modeling situations. Thanks for watching, and you're watching the Modeling Issues from Hell series. Thanks for watching, my name is Gleb Alexandrov. If you want to watch the full version of the course, with 80 plus tutorials about 3D modeling, just like this one, feel free to get the full course by following the link in the description on either Blender Market or Gumroad, whatever you prefer. Your support is much appreciated. Drink more coffee, and we'll change the world of computer graphics.